IVM.
From delivering milk and newspapers in the morning to writing codes on amazing softwares, my guest today is now delivering nirvana. He's helping people with his pranic healing and meditation and everything in middle to attain the most important question is to find their meaning of life. He has had a very interesting journey from being a loner, staying with his parents, to becoming a yogi now. It's my absolute pleasure to welcome on the show the one and only Ronak Gajjar. He is also my own meditation guru now. So it's exciting to actually have a conversation with my own meditation guru and meditation coach. So Ronak, welcome to the show. Really excited to have you here.
Thank you so much, Vishal, for
having
me. Yeah.
It's amazing. I mean, your journey of what you've been able to do has been so fascinating. Please tell me a little bit more about your childhood, because you grew up in a very conservative Marwadi and Gujarati combination, right? It's a and how was that growing up? And, you know, tell me a little bit more about your family.
So, first of all, thank you for having me on the show. And it was very different. I started, let me tell you about a little bit of history of my parents. Where are they from? So my dad is from Gujarat, Bhavnagar. And my mom is from Indore. And if we have read the school textbooks where Akbar Birbal had 9 jewels. So one of the jewels was Toradmal, Raja Toradmal. And from that lineage is my mother.
Oh.
So from all the Rajgharanas. And,
so and blue blood is literally flowing in your veins.
Yes, business blood. But yes. So they were too much into their own rituals, but never religious when they got married. So I saw them in a very different view. The perspective was very different when they were together. They never asked me or forced me to do traditionally go to any temples, church, mosque. And no question asked, whatever you feel like doing, you can do. A very open hand for how I should be, rather than teaching me to go to A, B, C, D set of places like that.
So basically, your parents were from Gujarat and Madhya Pradesh, MP.
Correct.
And they moved to Mumbai, and that's where you were born?
Yes.
And pretty much all your childhood was in Mumbai itself.
Right.
And at what point of time did you start becoming more and more independent? Because I know you started like working or, you know, like earning much earlier.
Correct. So at the age of 10 or 12, I started off as a milk seller.
Milk seller?
Yeah. So door to door giving milk to my school friend's house and all the local areas.
And
wherever.
This was in which part of Mumbai was this?
It was in Santa Cruz Prabhat Colony.
Okay.
And
so folks from Santa Cruz Prabhat Colony, you never know, Ronak Gajjar could have been your milkman.
I guess, yes, for sure. And then I got a hold of a friend who took me from east to west as a paper seller.
So you then started selling paper in Santa Cruz West.
Correct.
East me, you were a milkman, and West me at the age of 12.
Yes.
Wow.
So again, I was blessed to have those friends who could guide me to right places instead of taking me to wrong places. So that's when I started door-to-door paper selling in Santa Cruz West for a few months. And luckily, immediately after that...
And you were in studying also at that same point of time?
Yes, a full-time school. So before school, you have to go and deliver the papers from 4 a.m. to 6 a.m., then come back, get ready.
And that's when you are 12.
Yes.
And, you know, we have today's 12-year-olds and 10-year-olds who are on their phone 24 hours a day. And so it was a tough childhood, looks like.
I would say it was a beautiful challenge, which I was able to accept. I was blessed again without any parents or any... You know, counseling, which most of today's children have been privileged with. I was always counseling myself from that age.
Wow.
How do I
At the age of 12, you were counseling yourself.
Yes.
And what were the kind of questions you were answering for yourself?
So questions like, should I be playing the victim or should I be playing the leader? Because everyone goes through their different childhood. At least I was blessed with parents and house and food. The basics were taken care of. It was only the school fees and tuition fees which had to be, you know, worked on. So yeah, it was
possible. And what were your parents doing that time?
So my father had a very small shop in Marine Lines. He used to repair watches. Mm-hmm. And my mother was a mehendi artist. So she used to make mehendis and, you know, beauty parlor stuff.
Oh, wow. Mm-hmm. So you had a very creative, at one side very creative and one side very business. It was the creative and business combination flowing into you.
True that.
And then you ended up doing engineering also, right?
Yes, I studied from NIIT just for a small diploma. So I could get into an SQL DBA, like a database admin job. Because at that time when I was growing up, IT was the most prestigious and respected jobs in Marwadi today, Gujarati
even today,
families.
Even good today, right? I mean,
yeah, that's true. Yeah, now also it has been a lot of respect and love. But since Trump came into picture, I guess things are changing. But in India still,
well,
we have a lot of...
The good thing about Donald Trump is he's forcing people to think of products and IP.
Correct.
Because you can't just sell services now. So I think it's actually a very good thing happening. Anyway, but that's a discussion for later.
Mm-hmm.
So you pretty much became independent at the age of 12.
Mm-hmm.
You were, you know, doing all these odd jobs.
Mm-hmm.
What was the kind of reaction you had from your friends and peers? You know, what were they thinking? Because I don't think so other kids were doing this.
So I hardly had any friends. Probably till I got into 9th or 10th grade, then I remembered that I started having some friends who were very close to me. When I was 8th or 9th grade, I started going to clubs as an assistant DJ, so carrying
wires.
You were
also a DJ?
Not a DJ actually, but I used
assistant
to just
DJ.
Assistant DJ, so helping with wires.
Well, the best
and
thing is
stuff.
You can come up with all these new positions, right? Assistant DJ.
True.
Because DJ itself was people are trying to say, DJ kya hota?
Kya hota? So I was blessed again to have the right set of people at that time. Yeah.
So from milkman to newspaper to assistant DJ.
Correct.
So you were a lot into music. How did this happen?
So again, everything was focused around money at that time. So it was a day job where you go as an assistant, help. And clubs like dance clubs and lounge were new. The lounges were new. And that's where if you assist, you get
paid. J49.
Yes, and Irish club in Khar.
Yeah,
that's
Irish.
Where I used to do my work.
It was raspberry rhinoceros.
Raspberry rhinoceros,
yeah,
as well.
I know all the... Does raspberry still exist?
Still exists. It came back into the limelight after Raz.
Yeah.
So all of these clubs just go help the DJ, move the wires, move the laptop, get the song list. And get paid by the hour, which is good.
And you have sisters and other family members. And what were they doing? Did they have a similar background or what were they up to?
So out of my three sisters, one of the sisters chose to invest in education. The other two did not choose to study a lot. They all got married by the time I was 12. So they had married and some of them had kids and they moved out. And, you know, in India, it's I guess it's the foreign culture which we have adapted very beautifully for females, especially the daughters, where after marriage, we don't know you. The relationship goes down a lot.
They have their own
new
families and they have their own...
Correct.
So they were in Mumbai or they moved around the country?
So out of three sisters, one is in Mumbai and one is in Gujarat, Ahmedabad, and the third one is in US now.
But I think the biggest turning point in your life happened when your parents decided to move out.
Correct.
And do you remember that day? What happened? What did they tell you and how did you react?
So I always had an idea that my father would move out to an ashram first. But considering that I was never ready that, he will move out for good. And also taking in mind that we are Indians and the mothers don't leave the kids very easily. So my mother stayed back for a year. And at the age of 18, she tried to make me and convince me to get married. I saw a lot of girls when I was 18. But I somehow convinced her to go with her husband and move forward with a spiritual life. I don't remember the day because it was already imbibed in my system that since the age of two, I was initiated at the age of two by this master. And by 5-7 years, every month we used to visit to that ashram.
And which ashram is this?
It's Atma Malik Ashram in Shirdi.
Okay.
And every month we used to visit at least 2-3 times to Shirdi. So I knew somehow he will land up there and might be possible
three
that
three times a month. And that time going to Shirdi was like an 8-hour trek, right?
Easily. So you catch a bus to Dadar and Dadar to train to this, that. So it was crazy, hell of a ride to reach Shirdi. And from there also, it's not in main Shirdi. It's 5-7 kilometers away. So you get into trucks, you get into whatever vehicle possible. Sometimes we have walked halfway. It's that way to reach that place.
So from the age of two, you were meeting your gurus. Okay. And your father was also heavily into, or is into heavily into spirituality himself?
He started with 50-50, like 50% religious and 50% spiritual. But he never forced his religiousness to anyone. So his rituals used to start at 3:30 until today. He's 75. He wakes up at 3:30 in the morning and first WhatsApp is like a greeting mantra for me.
3:30 in the morning he wakes up.
Till today.
I know there are a lot of people here who go to sleep at 3:30 in the morning.
So yeah, it's been crazy. But then, so I taught him WhatsApp and like just 2 years back. Since then, I've hardly missed a message that 3:30 a.m. he will message me, 3:45, just a normal...
And he will send you like a shloka or a mantra.
Just a mantra, yeah.
Wow. And you wake up at 3:30 to see the receive the mantra?
No. I wake up at 6.
Okay. I was like, oh God. You know?
No way.
So you wake up at 6. Okay, chalo. That's at least something which makes it okay. So you were like 17 or 18 when they decided to move out?
So 18.
You were 18. You know, most 18-year-olds are figuring out. I mean, they've not figured out life. Mm-hmm. And both your parents are saying, son, we are taking sannyas.
Correct.
And we are going into an ashram.
Right.
And you are on your own.
Right. So I was, again, I'm very grateful where my mother made sure that at least a year she is there with me. For 1 year, she was there with me. And by that time, I was working in IT, good jobs into call centers in IT. So I could figure out of staying alone when I was 18 and, you know, be on my own completely without mother, father, everyone.
Wow.
So that was...
I have to tell you, for people listening here that, you know, like I said, that right now parents are so possessive about their kids. Forget about age of 18. People after marrying their kids want them to live with them and they're not willing to give up, you know, till the last day. And here you are, all of 18 years old, and your parents saying that, you know, you are on your own.
Correct. Again, my father was very generous. So he gave me a lot of cash that time.
What was a lot of cash?
A lot of cash as in at least for a 6 months rental is taken care of. That was, again, hardly something at that time. But for me, who's just trying to figure out the jobs in between, that cash was good enough to...
So the other way of thinking it is ki boss... 18 ka ho gaya, pitaji ne bola, ye lo bete, paisa lo jo karna hai karo.
So,
is that what happened?
So
you were like, wow, ye to meko lottery lag gayi.
So it was a kind of lottery because you've always earned it and never got a chunk of money in your hand and someone saying, spend it as you like. You have 6-8 months to figure it out in this much of money, this much amount. And after 6-8 months, life will start. So you choose, you want to blow up the money right away.
What if you had blown up all the money and got back to your father and said, "Sab paisa khatam ho gaya," then?
I would have to stay with him in the ashram.
that was the catch. So now I understood the catch. The catch was, you know what, we'll give him the money, he'll spend it all and then he will say, "Daddy, paisa nahi hai," then he'll say, "Now stay in the ashram." Was that his original plan, you think?
No, I guess. He asked me, he invited me quite a few times, okay? You should stay in the ashram.
But 18-year-old is DJ, assistant DJ, is okay. Not going to be staying in an ashram, right? I mean, it just doesn't...
So, yeah, but I was never into an idea of an ashram that time. But I would say I was a rebel child, a lot of rebellious by nature. The reason being, when you see your parents doing something and still you would like to, you know, you see the all the graphs are not going up, finances, relationship, this, that, and still they are religiously, dedicatedly, consistently doing their rituals and teaching me to do rituals and sharing those rituals with me that, okay, you can do this. And one fine day they said, just move. So I said, no, I'll figure out my own ashram. I should have an ashram with my set of criteria, the checklist.
So you're like, okay, I will go to an ashram, but not your ashram. I will want to find my own ashram.
Correct.
Wow. That's amazing. So tell me, what is the difference between being religious and being spiritual? You kept saying that, oh, they were religious and spiritual. So isn't that the same?
It's a lot different that way. Being religious means you are always looking forward or connected to the god or goddesses. And in India, we have abundance of gods and goddesses.
God, yeah, there are a million gods.
Million gods. And spiritual is where you have a direct connect with the divine energy. So there is no Shiva, no Brahma, no mosque, no church. It's just humanity is the first religion of spirituality. So when you are spiritual, you're human first, and then rest everything will follow.
So spirituality is basically to the creator, whoever the creator is.
Correct.
And religion is specific for something. You have Ganesha, for something you have Hanuman, for something you have Shiva. So you kind of,
true,
you know, have different gods for different things. So
That's true.
So that's the only difference.
That's
otherwise what they say and do and mean is the same.
Exactly the same, because all the religious scriptures, many of them are manipulated in the course of time, but all the religious scriptures, I've read a few, not a lot, but they mean the same thing. Be human, take care of your parents, take care of this, take care of that, take care of the society. But we have forgotten that. So that's where they start with two agarbatti, yeah, go to Ganesha.
My favorite thing is that mazhab nahi sikhata aapas mein bair rakhna, right? No religion will tell you to have
not
a fight
all.
Or
not
to do
all.
Any of this. This is all the interpretations.
That's true.
But once again, right, I have not met many 18-year-olds who are at that age thinking about, I'm going to find my own ashram.
Correct.
And I'm going to. So what was the difference? I mean, you know, there are kids and there have been, you know, other guests on my show who at the age of 18 were doing rave parties and who were figuring out which international MBA to do and many girlfriends. And I'm just saying that this is not the life of an 18-year-old.
Again, here I would say a very important part which played for this to trigger was, I'm visiting that ashram because every master has their own silence and different energy. So just visiting him used to make a difference that some humans can exist in this form, you know, where only love is emitting, only care, kindness is emitting, and they're not expecting any single rupee. So nowadays, ashram starts with money, ends with membership, and goes to crazy
spaces. I mean,
spaces.
Religion is a business now, unfortunately, right?
Correct.
These things are businesses and babas are billionaires.
That's true. That's true. So that's where I could, I was triggered by his energy that I don't want to stay in his ashram, but I would like to explore my own because my parents are, you know, constantly following it.
But, you know, there are other people whose parents also follow religious gurus and do
correct.
All of this. But I've not seen this happen to other kids.
So that's where one of my gurus gave me an answer that your journey is not from this life.
Oh.
And I had this as a question, because this question definitely came to me. And many times many people ask me this question that you are so young and, you know, you're not even half my age and you're so spiritual. But it's nothing about me. It's about, I was blessed and my journey had finished to a certain age in the last lives. And luckily, I could continue it from there, or that awareness started happening at the age of 18.
You believe you are a reincarnation?
100%.
That's interesting. Do you know who's reincarnation, or do you have any idea or any guess about that?
I'll open not a lot of secrets here, but a little bit. I did my past life regression with many people. So again, it's a proper science where they open your subconscious mind to a place where your soul imprints are open and you can see your past lives as visions. So few of the lives I was a monk.
Ooh.
And that's where I understood, if one person is saying, and I went into that hypnotic trance, and I could see monk, okay, it may be my illusion. And it was around 12 years back in 2007-8.
And how old were you that time?
Again, 19 or something.
At 19, you were seeing monks and not, you know, some Bollywood actress or Hollywood star.
Again, I was...
Clearly, you are reborn. Anybody who's born in this generation, if you would go into their deep minds, you would certainly see... at least in my case, you'd be seeing games or something else. But it is not going to be monks, for sure. But, you know, that's the interesting part, right? I mean, I think, you know, the calmness of your face definitely says that you were a monk in your old life. But as we say, you know, monks are all about owning and selling Ferraris today.
Correct.
So how did you decide? And I know you like to ride Ferraris a lot and you did a lot of that in Dubai. So how did your journey take you to Dubai?
I was working as a yoga teacher for one of the companies again.
That, before that, you were into IT, right?
Before
you started
that,
as a career in IT.
I worked as an IT support engineer for 4 years.
And this is with Aditya Birla.
So 1 year for Aditya Birla, 2 years for Wipro, and so on and so forth. Like a lot of companies.
So you were like a hardcore monk in his old life, you know, like spirituality, yoga, and they are making you do SQL database management. How horrible is that?
Yeah, I figured that out in a year's time.
And that, what was like, what time did you used to practice your yoga and how was your routine like?
So since childhood, there was no yoga in our system. So only yoga classes I could afford to attend was in one of the oldest yoga institute in the world in India. I was again blessed, or maybe it's a karmic alignment. I was born 10 minutes walkable distance from Santa Cruz Yoga Institute. And I could go for some drop-in classes that time.
Oh, wow.
And my parents always taught me to sit and talk to yourself. So close your eyes and start talking to yourself without opening.
How do you sit and talk to yourself?
First, it was a very weird idea that, you know, just pray without opening your mouth, chant all the mantras with mouth closed. And I said, like, you're crazy. But it starts happening when your inner, you know, Atman, or you say soul, you say your inner voice, the good voice. And first, he will listen. He or she will listen to you. And after sometimes your intention is clear, your vision is clear, they will respond back to you. So that's when they said, do it for years. So I almost gave up for a lot of times. But then sitting with yourself is the best thing. You get all the answers in the world.
So basically introspect.
Yes.
So you were introspecting all your, in all your childhood life.
Yes.
Literally. And you then learned from NIIT this whole...
Correct.
Software engineering and database management, and you went into IT.
Correct.
And from IT to teaching yoga, that was a huge jump. How did that happen?
Now, when I was 23, 24, at that age, like I finished my IT jobs and I was tired of it. The corporate routine life. And I used to visit my parents once in a few months, depending on the holidays and stuff. And I saw my parents being so happy in last 4 or 5 years, doing nothing. And here I am doing so much, working on code, seeing one slash is missing, my boss is on fire, and, you know, making all the money, enjoying, and lot of girlfriends and, you know, friends.
Yeah, you had a count. We'll talk about that later, but yeah.
So lot of partying and all the naughtiness I did in 4 years to keep myself happy. Obviously, I was staying alone, you know, like a bachelor with set of friends and all. But I was not finding the peace and the happiness. And when I saw my parents, their journey had changed when they had visited and stayed in the ashram in 4 years. They had a 360 degree change in their relationship, in their way of looking at life, and a lot more had opened for them. In 4 years, I think they lived 100 years there. It's that kind of awakening happened to them and still happening.
So, wow, that's amazing.
And that changed, that really, you know, changed me, that if they can do nothing and they are so happy, I should work towards doing nothing.
But once again, right at that age, people are not really thinking about all these, right? People
Correct.
Are thinking about partying, and you did a lot of that, right?
Correct.
And on last count, you said you had 300 girlfriends.
Yes, 300. So it was one of those nights when I met friends and you get drunk. and write all the girls' name which you have been with. So it was 300. So my friend was like, and then I didn't remember the count because I was too drunk. And I'm like, this girl gave me this emotion, this girl gave me that emotion, because it was like an energy healing game. That
energy healing game.
Where you remember that which breakup has changed you.
Wow.
And what has happened.
So guys, all the people listening out here, that even if you have to play a game of life, play the energy healing game and figure out all the people who give you positive energy, right? The Correct. Goal of your game is to avoid people with negative energy.
True, true that.
The Vishal Gondal Show will be right back after this break.
Hello, everybody. Welcome to another awesome week on the IVM Podcast Network. If you are not following us on social media, please make sure that you do. We're IVM Podcasts on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram. We'd like to thank the sponsors on our network, Storytel, Savari, and Paytm Money, for their support and really appreciate it. It's been a busy month at IVM. Last week, we launched 3 new shows. We launched ADKT Talent Tent. We launched Business.Next in partnership with Bloomberg Quint. And we launched Equity Sahi in partnership with Motilal Oswal. And this week, we're going to bring back an old favorite. We're going to come back with the Empowering series after a fairly long hiatus. I hope that you guys enjoy that. Life coach Zarina Poonawalla is joined by our co-founder Kavita Rajwade to discuss how you can put your game face on at your workplace. On the scene and the unseen, Amit Verma is in conversation with American philosopher and political scientist Jason Brennan. They discuss the ethics of government and voting, democratic theory, and the foundations of modern commercial society. On Advertising is Dead, we're celebrating the 25th episode with an AMA special. Varun is on the hot seat answering questions from our listeners and the guests who've been on the podcast so far. Dating is Garbage recorded its last episode of the season, in which our hosts Janam, Surbhi and Abbas look back at their favorite moments from the show. On our Parsi food show, Not Just Dansak, Parzain talks to Cyrus Dotiwala, the owner of Dotiwala Bakery in Surat, about the invention of batasas and the Parsi sweet tooth. On Football Twaddle, the season has come to an end, and the boys are geared up to share with you the final results of the English Premier League. On Business.Next, host Govindraj Athiraj talks to Kevin Freeberg, founder of San Diego Consulting Group, about the key success factors that can be emulated by competitors and other industries. On Shunya One, Shiladitya and I are joined by the General Manager Asia of Point, Pratyush Prasanna. We talk about the importance of smart terminals in the market and more. On Equity Sahib, brought to you by Motilal Oswal, Shrey Lunkar, Senior Vice President and Fund Manager PMS, talks to host Anupam Gupta about the evolution and potential of the Indian banking sector. And with that, let's move on with your shows.
So you played this game with 300 girls, and how many of them gave you positive and how many of you gave them negative energy?
Almost 80% of them took away the energy. Not negative, but they took away my energy, and 20% were positive.
Yeah, I mean, 300 is a big number. But like we were discussing, right, Sri Krishna had 1600 girlfriends, so you still were just small.
Not even one third or half of
less than half of Sri Krishna's record. But yeah, that's a, like I said, that's a different discussion.
Correct.
And while all this was happening, you decided to go to Dubai.
Right.
And like, how did you become a yoga teacher in all this?
So there was a very interesting, a company based in Bangalore. And in that company, when I started doing, so they hire you as a yoga teacher. They take your background check, do all the background checks and your attitude and all. And they put you in a villa, like the Big Boss show. And 3 months you're off sugar, you're off alcohol, you're off phone, you're off everything. And it's a secluded in a jungle kind of villa. So every day an auto guy comes with all the food for daily stuff. So in 1.5 months...
Whoever survives this can work for that company, basically.
It was that way. So 3 months was a very... big test, a challenge.
When and what I do thought, they like you do yoga 24 hours basically there?
So, yes, almost like 6 to 8 hours asanas and practice, theory part and, you know, anatomy part and physical practice part. So, attitude part, like how are you treating your fellow members? And so, everything was noticed. There were cameras everywhere, how you behave, what you do.
What is this company called?
It was Bharat Thakur Artistic Yoga.
Bharat Thakur Artistic Yoga. This should be the Big Boss Yoga Special.
Yeah. So at that time, we were lucky that, you know, there was no company who gives you a teacher training and pays you money for it.
Okay.
So again, working on the finances after my IIT, I had saved some and I had spent most of the money on doing my healing courses.
Oh, so you did all these courses.
So hypnotherapy, chakra healing, sound therapy, singing bowls, and a lot more, like at least 10 plus certifications. And again,
and how do you decide to do all these certifications? Like, how do you find all these things?
So find as in you visit an ashram and you find something interesting. And I guess today's young generation would, and everyone would relate to this. And this is a message. Whenever your heart says that you feel like doing something, just do it. So basically, this is a beautiful message for everyone, young, old, everyone, that whenever your heart says to do something, you should just go for it. In India, we are conditioned a lot that whatever you like or love to do, try and avoid doing that. Don't do that.
Nobody wants to listen to the heart. Everybody wants to listen to the brain.
Yes. And I followed the brain in the beginning to go to the IT path. But when I left IT and I had some money saved, I thought that doing a healing courses would be great. So basically, this is a point for every generation, especially the youngsters and, you know, the old people who are working, people who are retired, at any age. Whenever your heart says something, you should definitely follow it. So when I was deciding the healing courses, I was visiting different ashrams. And I would find an interesting person playing the singing bowl. And I would just go to him and say, can you teach me this in a barter or small amount of money? And most of the time they used to agree for barters, and somewhere I used to spend
what
some...
did you barter with?
So these were
coding. I will teach you coding.
I wish. So most of them were foreigners. And so basically they didn't know how to speak Hindi, go to the, you know, most inexpensive places to eat breakfast, lunch, dinner, and I could be their, you know, translator or a travel guide. So that was the best.
So it's amazing how foreigners are teaching people in India all these things.
Yes.
How is that happening?
Again, because of the Indian mindset, I feel we are still conditioned. And I had a very good conversation with one of the persons back then that gulami hamare blood mein hai, because we were ruled by some Western countries for a few hundred years. And before that, we were ruled by kings and queens. So whenever we see white skin, it is conditioned that, oh, they know it all. But I'm not against any skin color, no racism. Obviously, meditation, everyone's one. Vasudev Kutumbakam. But so they used to have scientific proofs. And we are still searching to set up a basic lab for meditation yet. And if there is a lab, they are not given to youngsters like us. So, yeah, I had to learn it from them.
So you learned literally from the best gurus then, right?
Yes.
So what is pranic healing? I mean, I've heard about all these things. What are all these other things?
So everything is basically energy. So I started with Reiki. I went to energy healing. I did hypnotherapy. I did chakra therapy. All of these therapies were having energy anatomy. So when there is a physical anatomy where you say, this is my hand, my leg, there are certain set of chakras. There were 7 chakras, which are major. Now it's popular because of the internet. But there are 36,000 minor chakras. There are chakras where you just touch and it can, you know, awaken a person to next level. All these are discovered but not out in the market. So I was blessed to have the right teacher to teach me this energy anatomy. And after that, all these therapy sessions, which is with the, you know, some are product based, like singing bowls, we need some physical product. And some are just hand-based. You draw some symbols in Reiki, advanced Reiki, and things starts getting to healed.
So, you know, a lot of people are very skeptical about Reiki especially, right? Because like what you're saying is I could be sitting 1,000 kilometers away and I can send you energy to treat things. What is the science behind this?
So, science...
I mean, if there's no science behind it, what is the logic behind this?
Yeah, so there is a very huge logic. And of course, there is a... It's more scientific than the actual science which we have. That's called spiritual science. And sometimes I call myself spiritual scientist when I'm researching with different techniques. The science is, I said the shloka, Vasudev Kutumbakam. So everyone thinks that everyone on this planet is one. It's the whole world is one. Mm-hmm. One big home. But it's more deeper than that. We have a universal mind, and with that help of that universal mind, you can transfer energies from one person to another by their photograph, by their name, by their just the glimpse of them, you can send in positive energies from anywhere in the world. And I don't remember the doctor's name, but there is an Australian doctor. She conducted a test keeping the plants hundreds and thousands of kilometers away, and three plants were given bad words from far and three were given good words and appreciation. And the one which were given appreciation, they started growing faster, recovering and growing, becoming bigger and stronger. But the one which were abused were dying off.
Wow.
So these
This is like some very advanced technology. Literally, like, you could remote locate people by just their photo or name.
Correct. So it's just how you train your intuition and mind, and you can learn everything that's possible. Yes.
So you did these 20 different courses.
Mm-hmm.
Was there any particular, you know, technique which you really thought was the most amazing and most beneficial?
Yes, there were many, quite a few of them. I loved the most personally, and what people loved the most was sound and energy healing. So in sound healing, it's a passive format of healing where you, and people love doing nothing and getting healed. You know, if I do nothing and I get healed, wow. So you're just lying down, and the singing bowls are played in a certain pattern and a format. And these, my teacher taught me the best thing, never to follow a pattern. It was always intuitively, you will get these downloads and you will play it in a pattern. So sound healing is what works the best. And second is energy healing. Energy healing has, again, various branches, where one branch has a lot of sacred symbols you draw. One branch is like Reiki, you just place your palms and heal the person from distance. One is do it on the photographs.
But you know, if all these things are there, then why is there so much suffering in the world? Why are so many people sick and why are so many people dying? I mean, if Reiki indeed can, you know,
cure
all of this.
So what I can speak for myself here is that if we have a spiritual lab, a space where we can experiment and prove, and this industry would boost 100 times faster than the pharmaceuticals or any kind of medical industry.
Mm-hmm. So,
and I have seen cases personally myself with one of my sisters who taught me Reiki. People from ICU have got healed in 3 days. And I'm sure the healers and the people who are listening, they might have some or the other cases where healings and prayers have worked magically. Mantras, chanting have worked magically.
Yeah, there was this very famous case on, I think I saw it on Twitter or Facebook, of this lady who had cancer, and they said, like, Guru Granth Sahib and this whole Gurbani was curing her, and, you know, she's like now. Yeah, so I mean, definitely these words, and they have some energy, nobody knows what.
Correct.
So, you were 24, 25, and, you know, once again, you are in the middle of this whole energy world.
Mm-hmm.
But you are not the typical 24-year-old who is, you know, just spending time partying and Correct. Doing everything else.
Mm-hmm.
You had a very serious side to yourself, which was about being extremely spiritual. So how did you manage both these lives together?
Blessed. Simply, I could say it's just blessings of parents and masters.
Yeah, you can't just say, well, everything is blessings of parents and masters.
So it was a, you know, it's inner quest, obviously your curiosity.
So you never had doubts, you never had, you know, all kinds of insecurities. I mean, this is what people are going through, right?
So I really wanted to talk about insecurity, but we'll keep it for a little later. But I had very minimal doubts, because I would suggest here, for myself, I had seen the worst. I had nothing to lose. So if you have something to lose, you are insecure. If you look in a certain fashion and you say, oh, I look the most handsome, most beautiful person out here, and oh, if I do spiritual work and people will treat me as a Baba or a Guru, and you don't want to do that, then you'll be insecure. Oh, then I have to start comparing. But there was no comparison. And as I'm coming from a background where my parents were like struggling to work and meet their ends meet, I said, what will I lose the next? Maximum, I would lose everything, the money, the name, the basic name which I had, which a 24-year-old doesn't have any in my, you know, software career. And I had to move back to an ashram. So I thought to go all out and learn as much as I can. So only thing which I did, the best thing is invested in my Saraswati every time, educating, self-educating on all these courses.
Wow. No, I think that's a very important thing, right? So like I keep telling people that, you know, most people think that once they have done their graduation or post-graduation, padhai khatam.
Correct.
You know, and my point to them is that just the way every phone you buy upgrades, every software upgrades, are you upgrading your own self? Are you upgrading, you know, you have got, you know, whatever BCom or PhD or BSc, whatever you have done. And that was in most cases done 10, 15, 20 years back.
Correct.
And people fail to upgrade themselves. And every other thing in the world, they want latest. But they do not want to become latest of their own mind. And that is the key mindset of a learner.
And again, gratitude to this beautiful platform which I've got introduced to, where we can upgrade and also work, where I am a meditation coach on Goki, where, you know, I can, from the convenience of my home, start giving some basic awareness and awakening through my meditations to them.
I mean, I have to tell you, like, sound healing, I'd heard about it, but only when I experienced it, I was like, man, this is amazing. You know, and not only me, right? I think the point is that, you know, it's unfortunate that a lot of us, you know, just ignore this science and think, hey, this is another world and I don't need to be part of this. People who are doing this are andhavishwasi and whatever, superstitious. And we all believe that people who indulge in this are different. And you always don't want to indulge in this. But when you experience this, and we kind of made it so easy, I think it opened a completely new world for me personally. And I'm sure for lakhs of other people.
Correct. So it is just how open you are to receive, because knowledge is sitting right at your doorstep and it's just your steps and efforts. And what I understand is first step is very difficult for people to take. And if you are ready.
So, you know, I believe that the most important step is the willingness to change.
Correct.
If you have that, anything is achievable. And most people lack that fundamental willingness to change.
Correct.
Agar wo hai, toh sab kuch ho sakta hai. Anyway, in your case, to forget about willingness to change. You were, your willingness was to, you know, reincarnate yourself into new things every time. And this is a time you didn't suddenly left India and went to Dubai after this Bangalore episode of yours. How was it living in Dubai?
It was blissful. I made a lot of friends again. I was in a relationship with my wife back then. And going to a whole new country where you cross the road and you can get a fine for it. And all the luxuries at your, again, at your fingertips. So it was a beautiful experience to stay in Dubai.
And you were teaching yoga there.
Yes.
Who were the clients who were learning yoga?
So there was bank VPs, managers and all of that, commoners and a lot of housewives and businesswomen. So every class after, so first I joined and there were two people coming for my classes. And within a month's time, there was 15, 20 people. And it grew up to every class going to 20 to 25.
25 people.
And there was a software where people used to book my classes. And in 3 years, so obviously the corporate mind kicked in and I took out a printout of how many people attended my classes at 30,000 plus in 3 years.
Oh, wow.
So on physical classes, maybe one class, trial class, free class, paid class, doesn't matter, but 30,000 on a physical.
Well, today too, you have, you're soon going to touch 30 lakhs, but yeah.
Yeah, again, it's again, you know, you just keep working and upgrading and you reach maximum people. That's your goal. Serve is the best goal.
Absolutely. Do your best without expecting any returns and things. Good thing happens to good people, as they say. And while this Dubai transition was happening, there was another big thing happened in your life. You decided to commit to someone. And that was also a very interesting story. You went and proposed to your senior. So like two levels, your boss's boss, and somebody who is much more elder to you in age, and somebody who is of a different religion also. I mean, clearly coming from this background, this was like the ultimate. So how did that happen?
Again, as we say, that you have to constantly surprise yourself. And if you don't give yourself these shocks, it won't work. And after meeting so many girls and women in my
300
life.
300 in your case,
yeah. And 300 is what I remember.
Okay, what you remember. It could be more. Okay.
No, there just is a kidding. Caveat. Just kidding. But jokes apart, where I saw her, I met her, and after first few interactions, I officially asked her out. In the second meeting itself, I was cleared. That's the level of maturity. That's the level of understanding.
So how did you judge this in like one meeting? What did you do? You did like some pranic healing on her? Or you did Reiki or meta-hypnotism? What did you do? How did you figure all this out? There are people who can't figure this out for years.
So again, it was all through meditation.
All through meditation? So you met her and you did meditation?
So no, the first meeting we went for a horror movie.
So first of all, she is your boss's boss.
Correct.
Super senior.
Right.
How did you go and approach her and tell her that, listen, I want to take you out for a date? How does something like this happen?
So it was a very filmy love story. I had to report to my immediate boss for an email, but instead I directly marked an email to her, leaving my personal mobile number, which is not allowed in corporates, but I did that. Took a risk that if she replies back, because we used to just share eye contacts and, you know, share, like exchange smiles. And within a day or so, she called me on my personal number and I know it had to take off.
Oh, to matlab, you had planned already, yeah, ki main mail mein apna niche mobile number likhunga. Wow.
I had
bahut dur ki sochi hai.
No, I did some energy healing, I guess, that time.
Oh, Reiki. Sending Reiki messages that my mobile number is there, and subconsciously you are sending.
Yeah,
you never know. Man, guys, be careful of Ronak. Every email he sends you may have other things attached to it.
Yeah.
And every WhatsApp.
Positive energy, I guess, now.
Okay, so you send this email with your number and she calls you, and what does she tell you on the phone? Yes, I want to meet you right now.
No, she said it was so obvious that you wrote your personal number there. So when do we meet? And the conversation started.
But hajaron logo ke mail mein personal number hota hai. I don't think so. Everybody thinks like because there's a personal number that this person wants to see me. I mean, that is but that was your energy working.
Energy working, and plus we had exchanged good time, you know, in distance, that, okay, smiling, looking, checking each other.
Nigaahon ka.
Pyaar. Aankhon se hi baat ho gayi thi.
Aankhon se hi baat ho gayi thi.
Conversation had to start.
Okay, that's good. I hope everybody is listening. This is how the pros do it.
Yeah, so if you use minimal words, the love can be expressed better.
Yeah. And people are writing songs and now rap. In Gully Boy.
Gully Boy, yes. So definitely they do that, but then the best is minimal spoken. If the partner understands you without you speaking, that's when it's the real partner. And Ooh. It will be a long-term relationship.
So how was that conversation? You said in the first date you went to a horror movie.
Correct.
And how did you transfer energy in that horror movie?
Because I love horror movies. You know, again, a shocker and playing with the mind.
You like horror movies?
I love horror movies.
Why? Because you think he is such to henny.
No. It's a different world which you could see through someone's imagination.
Which is your favorite horror movie you recommend everybody should see?
If you want to become strong-hearted person, then Saw, okay, all series, Saw 1, 2, 3, it's like a gore-cutting and horror kind of crazy movie.
Saw. Okay.
Saw. But you can start with Pari, if you like Indian horror movies. Pari is better, a little digestible for some people. But after the movie, we had a conversation that, okay, this would go on, let's meet for a second.
What is a date where you take your date to a horror movie? I mean...
movies, the... main thing, it's like, you know, you get a theater to get a personal intimate time with her. So that was the goal.
Pura theater khali tha matlab.
Nahi, sab bhare hua tha. It was first day, first show.
Okay.
In the morning. That was again a maddening thing which we did. Like first day, first show, and whole theater is full and we just wanted to stay closer to each other kind of thing.
Okay.
And then we had lunch and that's where we spoke all our heart out, and second meeting happened immediately within a week or so. And then we said, if we want to take this seriously or we just want to have this casually. And things got serious from both our sides. And I had proposed her first.
Did she know about her your 300 girlfriend, or did that come later?
That came a lot later.
Okay, now it's too late. I guess she already knows.
Now she knows. So that's totally fine.
Or I thought maybe you will in the first meeting say, by the way, 300 already done, so, not worked. No. Inner voice is talking to me.
Yeah. Please.
Energy is coming to me that you are the one.
Yes. So, no, it was again, it was a lot later in the relationship that we started opening and sharing. Because in India, we don't have live-in relationship to experiment first. Like, if you're going to spend
And does time, she come from a conservative family, or is her family very...
Very open, decent. Okay. Yeah, very nice. Because she is only having her mother. Her father passed away long back. So, no... That side, it was her mother and my parents are in ashram. So, you know, to make these families meet was a challenging task.
How did you make them meet? What happened?
I had decided, and after 4-5 years of continuing the relationship, I asked my parents that this is what I want to do. Because they were again like, you're getting older. We started since 18 that we should get married.
They started from 12.
I think, yeah, they should have started from 12. But then... After 5 years, then I said, this is what I'm going to do. I'm going to get married to her. She's 13 years elder than me. She's of different caste and she, you know, all of that. And they said, if you've decided, then why are you telling? But then somehow we made them meet for the first meeting, and they understood the vibe of each other. My parents, her mom, her sister.
And where did that meeting happen?
In her house.
Oh, so you actually got them from Shirdi. Okay.
And made them meet them at their house in Andheri. And that's where the conversation began. The kids have decided, we just have to agree.
And what kind of a marriage was this? How did the... Was it like a...
Big fat wedding? No. I'm a minimalist. And I believe in marriage, the most important thing, or in India, as they say, the marriage happens between two families. So we just invited all the families, and it was a court marriage in Bandra.
Mm-hmm.
Nothing major. We never do a reception or nothing, because what's the point?
Yeah.
The Vishal Gondal Show will be right back after this break.
Hi, I'm Ronnie Skruala, first generation entrepreneur and co-founder at Upgrad. My podcast, Dreaming With Your Eyes Open, is a companion podcast to my best-selling book, Dream With Your Eyes Open. On this podcast, I talk to Amit Doshi, founder of IVM Podcast, about my entrepreneurial journey. I walk you through my successes and failures, mostly my failures, and the lessons that I learned from my experiences, family, and colleagues. What was my first entrepreneurial venture? Why I chose Japanese cartoons over animation cartoons on Hungama? Why did I sell my stake at UTV to Disney? Find out all this and more on the Ronnie Skruala podcast, Dreaming With Your Eyes Open. New episodes out every Tuesday on the IVM Podcasts app, website, or wherever you listen to podcasts.
But then it was also very interesting that what you did with your wife, you took her to some amazing places. And this is not Switzerland and Italy. These were all the religious places in India. Correct. How did you convince her to make that journey, and how did it change you and her?
It changed us a lot as being together, you know, as partners. Not religious, but spiritual places.
Okay, spiritual and religious.
And religious. So I made a list of a set of masters, all these gurus, legendary gurus. And wherever they have taken their samadhi, so that's the places we went for meditation.
So which are these places?
So we started from Vrindavan, Neem Karoli Baba, where, you know, the Steve Jobs had stayed with him.
Oh, Neem Karoli Baba.
Neem Karoli
Baba. So even Zuckerberg went there recently, right?
Yes, and Narendra Modi.
And Modi ji, of course.
So Vrindavan.
So Neem Karoli Baba, what is the story of this guy? I mean, just if you can just kind of quickly summarize, why are all these people going to him?
So he had siddhis, or, you know, he had this energy from divine energy from Hanuman. So he was a hardcore Hanuman bhakt, and he had awakened certain powers which were equivalent to Hanuman ji. And very simple guy, praying, meditating, chanting. That's it. And people used to follow. His body was huge as Hanuman. It was 6-7 feet. I've seen his bed size. A normal human being cannot be that large. I've never seen that kind of large body size.
And now he has samadhi over there.
So his samadhi is there in Vrindavan. His body is there.
He's been there for how many years now?
Almost like 50, 100 years now.
100 years. Wow. So you went there first?
First.
Okay.
And then we went to Ajmer Sharif.
I have to go to Ajmer Sharif. Yeah, that's been on my list for a long time. But
we have to go together then.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
So wherever we went, what we did as an experiment was, if we have the presence, the divine presence, let's ask for proofs. Because I believed in it already. So I had like a blind trust. Because some certain miracles and certain things happened in my life, certain magic. But for her, it is very new concept.
You had magics and miracles happen in your life?
It is a miracle where I have reached so far, coming from where I am, right?
Okay, so that's a miracle. I was like, you know, miracle was, like, can you convert this into gold, this piece of wood? and you rub it and it becomes gold. I'm sure that has happened to you.
No, I wish that. By now, I would be sitting with some sheikhs in Dubai. But for her, the magic and miracles were very new. So we traveled from Neem Karoli Baba Vrindavan to Ajmer, Ajmer to Golden Temple, Golden Temple to Navsari, Gujarat, then Meher Baba in Ahmednagar, Gajanan Maharaj in Shegaon. So all half of India we covered from that.
So one second. So you take your wife to a trip where you go to Neem Karoli Baba, Then you go to Ajmer Sharif, then you go to
Golden Temple.
Golden Temple. Okay, we go there. That's a great place. And then you go to
Navsari, one of the meditation ashrams.
Navsari. And then you go to
Ahmednagar.
Ahmednagar. And what is the place in Ahmednagar?
Meher Baba Samadhi. Meher Baba Samadhi. So this saint was taking care of people who are mentally challenged. Mm-hmm. And he had certain, again, he was, okay, his story is super interesting for everyone, our listeners, you, me, everyone. So
I have passed Ahmednagar a lot of times, but I didn't know this. So maybe next time I can visit that summer.
100%. Again, that's the one of the hot spots we have to visit. Mm-hmm. He was enlightened by a kiss of a woman on his forehead. Straight 9 months in Samadhi. And after
woman that, kissed him and he went to Samadhi for 9 months.
Yeah. And that woman was a Sufi saint.
Wow.
And
this is, you're not making this up.
No, it's all on the Wikipedia or internet, I guess.
No, but just because it's on Wikipedia doesn't mean it's true.
It's his followers, everyone. Okay.
Yeah. And so he used to take care of the mentally challenged. So what was he doing with them?
So he used to, you know, take care of their basics, food, clothing, shaving their head, this, that, giving them food supply, making them sure they're eating from his hand and they're fed, well fed at that ashram. And still there is no commercial property in 2 to 5 kilometers of his samadhi till now. Like if you see any other ashram, so there are a lot of commercial stuff coming up. But it is still as simple, innocent, clean, clear, pure till today. You go there, you meditate, you will start sensing energy. If you had some connect or glimpses in your life, you will start having some connects.
Wow. So you go to these places and you then meditate for how long?
At one go, at least for an hour to 2 hours. Yeah. So it's like breakfast, then 2 hours, then take a break, have lunch, then 2 hours, then take a break. So every spot we spend 2 to 4 days, maximum 4 days, minimum 2 days.
Minimum 2 days.
So we were backpacking half of India.
And for her, who's again in the technical world,
correct.
You know, I mean, if you tell an average person, ki chalo bhaiya, hum ja rahe hain, all these tours to do meditation, it sounds crazy.
That's what makes you different, right? Agar junoon hoga, to he, you will,
I know,
it
I
will
mean,
show.
This has to be extreme passion. So how did you convince her that this thing is real? So what was her, I mean, I'm sure she was also skeptical, right? When
in the beginning she was, but when we were planning the days that we will never buy and tickets in advance, we'll just go and from there we'll book the ticket forward and that way we'll plan it. So if some place gives us more high energy, we'll stay there for a week. So we had planned our 3 months like that, like 2 to 3 months we'll be just off. So it took 2.5 months and summer started, so we had to come back.
Wow. Yeah. And what did she experience?
So I'll share two experiences. The first one was Ajmer Dargah. So I was meditating, you know, wearing the cap and outside the samadhi, taking...
There's too much noise there, right? Can you meditate? I mean, it's...
Very easily. Mm. So the silence, your inner silence cannot be disturbed by outer chaos.
Oh.
So when I sat there with her and she started chanting her mantras and I was doing my meditation with eyes closed, I asked for a proof that if you're there, I know you're there, I feel good here. It's the inner feeling. So show me a proof. So the chadar, which is kept right on the samadhi with a lot of ittar and, you know, the flowers and all stuff, it was folded that time and it was an unconventional time. So they do not have a regular time that they will clean the place at 5 a.m. only. They do it randomly because too much flowers, too much ittar. So they took out the chadar and they kept it on the wall where I was sitting. And from there, I'm just getting it like a person is tapping his hand. It was that kind of feeling when I was meditating. I was in deep meditation. And I was constantly asking, if you're there, give me a sign, give me a sign.
And
give me.
Upar se hai.
Chadar. And a lot of flowers fell from that chadar. I was like, who's throwing flowers at me? I'm not gone. I've not reached that nirvana stage yet. But then that was one. And then Meher Baba, where we were meditating in the samadhi, it's a small room. So only four people can sit in the room. So my wife is sitting in front of me and we get the same exact visuals. We come out, I say one line and she says one line. So those visuals were shared and it was like an intimate spiritual experience with this superpower master and these energy basically.
You also spent some time in at Osho Ashram.
Right, I did.
So what did you see there? Of course everybody has seen wild, wild country. So what did you see which was wild?
I never saw anything wild. My mentor who took me there, he said, if you really want to grow there, you just have to look towards the ground and walk. And be with yourself. We are not going there to make friends or family or whatever. So I saw a lot of different types of meditations. Crazy different styles of meditation. And that was my first ashram where I visited and, you know, stayed for a little longer. What I understood, and I read a few books and I heard him for a while. He had converted everything into meditation. So my book reading technique is I read only one page. I don't read the entire book. So whatever is for you, the wisdom will come in one page, whether you read the entire book or the...
Wow, that's an amazing life hack.
Yes.
You have to tell everybody how you can read one page and read the entire book.
Yeah, so when you meditate for a little while and you just randomly open one page and you will get a vibe of what the universe wants to communicate or the book wants to communicate to you.
In that one page.
Is enough.
Wow.
Is enough. So
that wow. I want to learn that.
So it's quite simple. I'll teach you for sure.
Nah, this is like the ultimate growth hack, guys. Everybody listening here, stop buying expensive books. Mm-hmm. All you need is meditation from Ronak. And you can open a book and read one page and read the whole book. But that's what it is.
Correct.
As they say, don't judge the book by its cover. Here you can judge the entire by the one pager, which is amazing. So, and how did this impact your wife? What changed for her?
She then moved into spirituality more. She was always spiritual. She's a Sufi follower.
Oh, okay.
And she used to do Sufi chants, Sufi dance and all of that. And then she understood my energy work very easily. So it was digestible for her once I started learning and taking her out for this trip. In Osho Ashram, I never saw anything, you know, going down or whatever was shown outside. Nothing was happening inside. I mean, you have 100 laws and you still have illegal stuff in any country, right? It's the same way. If you think about negative, the negative will grow. If you
when
think
you
about
see negative,
positive,
when you think negative, you'll only see negative things.
So I was just looking down, doing my different meditations there, learning. I was in my learning phases there.
So I have this experiment for people to try. And I have, you know, in my life, I have experienced this several times. It used to happen that whenever I was trying to buy a new car and I was thinking about that car, for the next few weeks, I could only spot that car on the road, you know. Somehow, out of all the cars going, I would just spot that one car. And that is when I started realizing that, you know, whatever you are thinking, your brain is seeking it.
Correct.
And if it can happen to a car, and I think you guys should do it yourselves, you know, whether it's a car or something which you can see very often, right? So car is a good example. Mm-hmm. Yeah, think of buying, or actually literally if you are planning to buy a car or a bike or a scooter or whatever, mm-hmm. you will see suddenly that one on the road a lot of times. And that's what is happening, what you just described.
Correct. So I did millions of experiments with the law of attraction in this manifestation rituals, which I designed my own personalized manifestation rituals. I, coming from a background where I used to sell papers or, you know, started working in call centers, IT, I could never imagine to drive a Rolls Royce or a Ferrari. But in Dubai, so I had written those goals down on my book, on my secret book. So there is a golden book which you write your goals for a year. And then you watch it a few times a year, read it, do some affirmations, relax, visualize it, relax. And I happened to be in Dubai with one of her friend, like a lot of, you know, people who rent out all these luxury cars there. And that's a very common thing there. And one of my friends said, okay, if you have this wish,
here
you go. And I was like, wow, can I go on the... But I didn't have the official stuff. So I could do it in the parking lot and do it at a very, you know, low profile streets.
Yeah, but technically, that was a tick. You did it. It didn't matter.
It did matter. So whatever you're thinking, a manifestation ritual is you write it down on a physical reality with your five fingers and the thumb. So it's your... five koshas, which we say.
So my favorite quote, and I something believe from as I was a kid, is you can if you think you can.
Correct.
I think the only thing stopping you from doing anything is your own thought.
Correct.
So ek bar, if you think and make a resolve,
it will happen.
It will happen. And I think that's exactly what you talk about. Mm-hmm. So tell me now, with this amazing journey of yours, you know, with all the interesting things around, you are now very seriously pursuing your own path to spirituality, but you are also now teaching thousands of people this path.
Correct.
So what is it that you are seeing in the society or in people today, and how do you think spirituality is going to help them?
I feel now, as we already know, that every corner has a yoga center now. So I started off as a yoga teacher, but in next few years, next 5 to 7 years or earlier, every corner will have meditation centers, because body is very important, of course, but people have left mind behind, and now is the time to take mind along.
Mental health.
Mental health is the biggest thing, challenge which we are facing today. So we get an average 8 to 10,000 people coming for a meditation class on a live platform. That's amazing. So that means people are looking forward to do something to resolve their queries of mind. And the easiest way is to work with your mind and breath, which is so close to you, but we forget the breath. We forget the breathing.
So you believe that every corner, there are going to be meditation centers.
Every corner. Meditation is going to be the next.
Are there enough meditation gurus to do this?
Meditation gurus, I won't.
Or meditation guides.
Guides also, gurus, teacher, guides, minimal, but there are enough. And I'm sure, like right now, Rishikesh in the yoga capital produces 1 lakh teachers, 100,000 teachers a month.
A month?
Yoga teachers. So I'm sure there will be, universe has its own alignment to produce that many meditation teachers as well. And it will happen for sure.
Wow, that's a very powerful, you know, thought, and I'm sure it is going to become that big.
Correct.
While all this is happening, you know, you have these amazing tattoos on your body. How did you set up all these tattoos, and what was this idea behind it? Because again, this is not conventional. You don't see a lot of these people. Of course, Luke has a lot of tattoos, but
correct.
Luke comes from a different world.
Correct. So, tattoos, I started into clubs as a that assistant DJ job. And I saw many people having tattoos at that era. So I was like, okay, I'm fascinated. As I turn 18, the first thing I want to do is a tattoo. So first tattoo was on my neck. It was a sun before. I redid the tattoo and got a mandala. So I used to meditate, and I used to always see a sun or a mandala or a sacred geometry coming into my third eye on my forehead. And like, I don't know why these things are coming up, but I should have something inked on my body. And my spiritual name is Krishna because of the same reasons. So Krishna is on my neck. And if Krishna is there, you always need a Radha, like Radhe Krishna kind, like the male and the female. So Shri is on my ear.
Oh, okay.
So Shri, Krishna and the mandala, which you often see on the throat.
Wow. That's an amazing story. And yeah. And I hope you're going to have more now, given that you're going to do so much more spirituality.
I wish. I'm searching for a mantra which I could resonate with and have it on my hands or somewhere other. Yeah.
So if somebody has only 30 seconds to a minute, mm-hmm. how can they meditate?
If you have 30 seconds, just place your palms on the stomach and every breath has to reach the navel. 30 seconds.
So how do you do that? Can you just demo? Yes. So everybody here, I'm just placing my hand on my stomach. Both the hands?
Both the hands.
Okay.
It's like you're blessing your stomach.
Okay.
And back is straight. Most important is to keep your spine straight and inhale slowly, very naturally, without making any sound. And slowly exhale from your nostrils. Breathing in gently. Exhale. With every breath, observe your navel rising up. With every exhalation, observe the navel falling in. Just 20 more seconds to go. Breathe in. Keep a beautiful smile on your face. Exhale gently through your nostrils. And now gently bringing your awareness back to your breath, back to the now, and slowly open your eyes.
Wow, that was 30 seconds of amazing meditation.
Yes.
So, but you know, that's what it is, right? So people think they don't have time, mm-hmm. but you know, there is a meditation for everything.
Everything. So from smoking, swimming, dancing, to making love can be
meditation. Wow.
So everything is meditation.
No, it has been really exciting talking to you. I have learned so many things. But before we end, I wanted to kind of talk about 2-3 other aspects of your life. Mm-hmm. And one very important is how do you deal with, you know, the negativity and, you know, things when things are not going right. How do you deal with that? And how can people learn that?
So the easiest way and the most practical way is pranayam, the breathing exercise. Nadi Shuddhi is one. You can do Kapalbhati as well. But that's the fastest way to deal with negative stress or negativity around, because negative energies cannot attack you before. So they reach their aura stage first. And aura is nothing but your pranic energy or the prana energy. So when you're breathing, you're keeping your mind cool. And science have proven already, if you're happy, you're breathing in a certain set rhythm. If you're angry, you're breathing in certain rhythm. So when you're breathing with that calmness, negative stress or any kind of stress will not stick to you at all. The second practical way is writing all the negative things down and burn it. Simple.
So you write all the negative things and then burn it.
Throw the ashes in the commode or just flush it down and wash basin or wherever. Just dump it. Do not keep it. Just burn it.
Wow. That's an amazing hack, guys. So one way to get rid of problems is write them down, burn it and dump it in the toilet.
Yes.
That's the way to do this. That's a good hack. And I'm definitely going to try that.
Yes.
Anything else which can help people achieve nirvana in the shortest possible way?
Nirvana, I don't know. But calmness, yes. If you really want to, you know, have that calm state of mind, is so whatever is in the mind is in the body, and whatever is in the body is in the mind. Start moving your body and then start working with your mind. So you can start with your yoga exercise like Surya Namaskar. Just 5 Surya Namaskars are enough. 4 to 5. They go in pairs. So 4 or 8 or 6 even numbers. Then you start with 5 minutes or 10 minutes of pranayam, including only Kapalbhati and Nadi Shuddhi pranayam from our Goki platform. And after that, just Shavasana. Play a beautiful music for 10 minutes. put your music on from any internet
source. And what about headstand? You know, I'm now an expert at that.
Yes, headstand and all the... So,
Shirshasan.
Yeah. Shirshasan. So, I guess the listeners would be surprised and shocked to know Yoga Sutras were written by Mr. Patanjali, the Lord Patanjali. And he wrote about asanas only 3 to 5 sutras. Out of 196 sutras, Yoga Sutras, he has only written 4 or 5 sutras on body postures. He has written everything on the mind, everything on the dream, everything on the karma, everything on the, you know, cosmic energies and stuff. So asanas are made now by humans, you know, again, manipulated and stuff. But asanas are very important. Body fitness is very important. But we have forgotten the core of yoga, the attitude of yoga. You should be having that attitude. Many yogis eat non-veg, drink, party, do everything. I do that. But I am a vegetarian, but yeah. but attitude matters more. So your mental attitude is the key to reach that state. There are only 2 stages, happy state and sad state. Mm-hmm. Either you're happy or you're sad.
So if today is the last day on earth, mm-hmm. you know, humanity is going to end tomorrow. Mm-hmm. And we all know today is the last day. How mm-hmm. will you spend that last day?
That is a one crazy question, but... I would be spending my time in a village, you know, just being in the nature, staying with the forest, animals, eating what I like, doing nothing, and just being in the nature, a part of nature. Yes.
So you will go to a village and spend time being part of nature?
Yes.
Nothing else?
Nothing else.
That's amazing.
That's meditation.
What is the last thing you bought, which is under 10,000 rupees, which you end up using a lot?
I've started using it now more, but I had bought it like in last few months. It's a gimbal. It's a phone gimbal, Zhenyun Mobile Smooth 4. So I'm trying to create my cinematic movies and, you know, short documentaries and trailers of yoga and meditation.
Yeah, so you can use your camera. Yeah, that's interesting.
From the phone itself, yeah.
And are you into music at all?
I love music, but I don't listen to a specific genre. Anything which makes me happy. Because I've studied a little bit of basic level one of Nad Yoga. There's a music yoga itself. So I love music, yes.
So any music you'd recommend people to listen to?
I would say start listening to the nature sounds, the singing bowl bells, or any religious chants which you follow, any religion you follow, any chantings, if you listen to for 10 minutes a day, would really change the neuro pathways.
So a lot of people I've asked that, you know, they all say, oh, I want to meet Dalai Lama. Of course, even I want to meet Dalai Lama. But you are one of the few people who have met him now a few times.
Yes.
So how was it meeting Dalai Lama?
In his space, you don't feel like talking. Once you are reached a certain level of meditation, I won't say that I am a super expert as he is. He's wow in that way. But when you are in that space, your silence will communicate with him. And whatever he says, it's like flowers showering on you. So the wisdom and the knowledge which you get, it's like one line is like 100 books.
So you have line is like 100 books.
And you have to decode that line. That's what, you know, is when you spend time with that kind of legendary master. Yeah.
So there are so many Babas in India, right?
Correct.
But if there are 5 Babas mm-hmm. or 3 Babas who people should really study or follow, mm-hmm. who would be those 3 and why should we be following them?
So the first, I would say, again, all of them have left their body. First would start with Osho.
Oh, Osho number one.
Because he's one of the masters who have spoken on every aspect of energy work, healing work, meditation work. So listen to him for at least 3 months. And then practice the meditation. Otherwise, you get into the listening mode only and you never execute. The first. The second, on the service end, you should watch. There are a lot of YouTube videos and internet videos about Meher Baba and his life journey.
Meher Baba, I'll surely check that out. Yeah.
That's again another level. And third and the last one would be Raman Maharishi. Mm-hmm. Raman Maharishi spoke on duality. So basically, as we had spoken about insecurity and, you know, either this is right or wrong, negative and positive. He has spoken about the midway, the this and the that. So non-duality and Advait philosophy, Raman Maharishi.
And what are your thoughts on Jaggi Vasudev and Shri Shri and Baba Ramdev? I mean, these are they seem to be a lot mainstream, and we know several people who are following them.
So they are amazing at what they're doing right now. I see that at least on their bit, they're doing some kind of awakening or information passing on to the people who are not aware. But after a while, you would not need them.
Mm-hmm. Your level goes up.
And second is, the real guru teaches you to 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 techniques. Says, if you can't awaken yourself and make yourself a guru or awaken the guru in you, and then you don't come to me.
Mm.
But most of these babas are selling one course, two course, 100 courses, and they are not awakening the real you.
No, but I think in a way they are at least taking this to the masses, right? I mean,
that is the most key.
Clearly, thanks to Baba Ramdev, yoga is on the map, at least in India. And, you know, Modi ji has adopted World Yoga Day, International Yoga Day and things like that. So they've been able to at least get the masses interested in this.
So they are the whole purpose. So every guru has their own purpose. So they had the purpose to make sure that this reaches and becomes the mainstream. Like Ramdev Baba, where he started, I used to attend his shibirs at 4 o'clock in the morning and 5 o'clock in the morning to reach millions of people. And now company worth 10,000 crores and above. Jaggi Vasudev with his wife taking Mahasamadhi, now a multimillionaire Baba, but amazing work done.
What he's done in Coimbatore is amazing. I want to go there actually.
Even I would love to visit. I've never visited that ashram. I've visited more than 200 to 300 ashrams all over India.
Wow.
But all are unfamed. So basically, when you reach the mainstream, the essence is gone, and you know, the intimate connection with the Guru Shishya Parampara is gone. Now, if I want to reach any of these, I have to go through 100,000 people, the PR agencies and all of that. So it becomes a crazy havoc.
And then what about Shri Shri?
I've done his courses, amazing ashram. But once you reach a level, you just need... So if any of these gurus can awaken the guru in you and say, go beyond me, I believe that's the perfect guru chosen for you. And they are amazing already. They're doing amazing.
But you know, apart from these gurus, there are a lot of people who are, I'm sorry to use the word, scamming people in the name of spirituality and religion.
Mm-hmm.
Do you have any tips for people on how to identify or if they know someone who is getting into this trap, how do you kind of give them some knowledge and take them to the right direction?
Correct.
Like the three babas, you have, like, except Osho, I have not heard of the other people. I doubt if any of our listeners would have.
Correct. So it's that's the first key. When you awaken your spirit, your Atma inside you, you have your Atma Darshan, you will never need to become famous. Because people will sense your energy and come to you. So when you're going to any non-commercial, non-famous personality, the guru, the vibration should talk and not the drama which is created around the vibration.
Mm-hmm.
So when you are in that presence, you will get into trance and meditative state without getting hypnotized. So mass hypnotism is a very big thing.
Mass hypnotism.
It happens at a very large scale, and it was very famous back in US, and now it is happening in India. But if it's happening for good, I'm always game for it.
So there are definitely challenges in that also, right? There are a lot of challenges. No, I think it's been a fascinating conversation, Ronak. I think we can go on and on.
Yeah.
But before I end, I think I want to know one last thing from you. Then, where do you see yourself 10, 20, say 30 years from now? You are what, 30 now, 31.
Yeah. Correct.
Where do you see yourself when you are 60?
So it was in a funny way. I had spoken to a few masters and I had asked them to teach me some sacred techniques to leave my body. And you know, when you're young, you can ask anything.
Yeah.
Now when you get a little wiser...
Why do you want to leave your body? I mean, which kind of a teenager or, you know, like 20-year-old is asking somebody, I want to leave my body?
Because why do you want to go through this cycle again and again? So it's not moksha, it's not nirvana, because that's very far. Enlightenment, it's very far.
So according to you, living a life is like going through hell again and again. Or
it's,
going through, it's
a kind of
Maya, whatever it's called.
It's a Maya punishment, or it's awakening. So you're gonna so why am I here? You're here to serve people. What are you gonna do? You're gonna make some money. You're again gonna give it to 100,000 people or millions of people. So why are you doing this drama again and again? Being rich, poor, any kind of, you know, from any race, religion, background, reach a height and start helping people. So why don't you do it now? So if I have served right now through Goki, I've served 200,000 people for even two minutes. And through other mediums, I've served X number of people and 30 years more serve people. But after a while, you would want to stop. Because where does it end?
So if you do leave your body, where do we find you? I would still want you to be live on Goki Play.
Then I guess we'll do some telepathy from Mars or some other kind.
No, but like I said, Ronak, an absolute pleasure talking to you. I know we spoke about many things here, but I think, you know, you are one of those persons whom we are going to call again on our show, because I know you're going to do some amazing things in the future. And once again, thanks a lot for being live on the Vishal Gondal Show.
Thank you so much for calling me. Thank you. I'm grateful.
Thank you.
India's a massive subcontinent, home to truly stunning diversity. Behind the veils of smoke that obscure our thriving cities, our history is still alive, glimmering like sequins, waiting to be discovered. And if you, like me, are straining to hear the echoes of our past, this podcast is for you. I'm Anirudh Kanisetti, a history and geopolitics researcher, and I host Echoes of India, a history podcast about India, by Indians, and for Indians. In Echoes, we journey through the complex histories of South Asia and what they can teach us about our globalized world. Tune in every Wednesday on ivmpodcast.com or your favorite podcast app.
The most engaging and the most useful conversations you may have in your life are likely to be with your most challenging customers. Hi, I'm Ambi Parmeshwaran, and on this podcast, I will take you through my book, Sponge: Leadership Lessons I Learned from My Clients. Packed with real stories about real people, but most of all, packed with the innumerable lessons I soaked up from some of the most iconic business leaders like Ratan Tata, Azim Premji, S. Ramadurai, Karsanbhai Patel, M. Damodaran, Dr. Kurian, and many more. Don't forget to tune in to the Sponge Podcast. Keep sponging to keep learning.